Hi friends, today we are going to discuss another design pattern called publisher subscriber pattern. Now this pattern has already been discussed in other videos and bits and pieces, so to consolidate all the points in a single place, I'm making another video. It will be a short one. So what is publisher subscriber pattern? For example, if particular services need to be integrated and they are not closely coupled, like publisher or this service does not depend on response for this service, or it has very less dependency on this service. So what we can do is, instead of directly coupling these two services, for example making an API call or making an RPC request to this service from service one, what we can do is we can make our service publish to a messaging system where all the messages are kept, and from this messaging system, the consumers or whoever's whichever service is interested in those types of messages consumes from this service. So what is a message? Message is just a payload of data. It can be a packet of data which service one wants to send to service two, or this service wants to send to this service. So that is a message, and the server system that we use for this processing is called messaging system. Now there are multiple open source messaging systems present in the market, like RabbitMQ, Kafka, and other cloud providers are also providing messaging systems like Amazon Kinesis and EventGrid. What you might think is, for example, if you have a one-to-one connection between publisher and subscriber, or publisher and consumer, so what you can do is you can create a messaging system connection like this, and if another service is consuming from this, let's say service X wants to read this message, you can a point can come into your mind that you can create another messaging system or another queue from where X can read, but this is going to make your solution inefficient, because as the number of consumers are increasing, suppose for example if Y also comes, then you have to make changes in your publisher to publish in a new queue, and from there these consumers can listen. So it is going to make your service a brittle one, because you have to make changes as and when new consumer comes in picture. So what you want is, you want a messaging system which can provide different channels. Now, what are channels? Channels are, for example, when publisher is publishing into the messaging system, this is called input channel, which is provided at screen. And when consumers are reading from the messaging systems, this is called output channel. So it is responsibility of a messaging system to provide input channels and output channels so that producers and consumers are totally decoupled. They can be scaled independently. For example, if speed of consumption of service C1 is less, then you can scale this service independently. You can add more instances like C1, which can basically load balance the messages which are being produced in the messaging system. And it is messaging system's responsibility to ensure that if any other service wants to consume a particular type of message, then it should allow that service to read from it. It should not be dependent on publisher. Publisher should only publish to the messaging system once, and all the parallel consumers that are publishing in the system, they should be able to get the messages, right? So what you are actually doing is, you are basically copying data in each channel, right? So if any other channel is created, output channel is created, then you will the messaging system will copy the data so that every message is provided to each and every consumer group. And within a consumer group, for example, let's say you launch more instances like C1. So this is called consumer group. This is called one consumer group. These are called one consumer group. C1, C1 dash, C1 dash dash, and they are part of the auto scaling group. So all the messages which are produced in this output channel will be consumed or load balanced by all the instances in C1 consumer group. What I mean by this is, for example, if you have messages like M1, M2, M3, M4, and M5, and these are being produced by publisher, and you have two consumer groups. This has C1, C2, C3, C4, and you have another consumer group like X1 and X2. So what is going to happen is M1 is going to be picked by this, M2, M3, and M4. Similarly, X1 is going to pick M1, M2, M3, M4, and like that. So all the messages are being consumed, are being duplicated in a particular channel. So this is one channel and this is one channel. And inside a single channel, they are being consumed or they are being distributed across the instances. So this is called one consumer group. C1, C2, C3, C4 are part of one consumer group, and X1 and X2 are part of another consumer group. In systems where there is very hard coupling between these systems, for example, if service S2 is down, then S1 will have to ensure that it will have to store the messages that should have been sent to S2 at some place, and it is going to increase the operational overhead in S1. Whereas in messaging system, what will happen is, if a particular service is down, for example, if this service is down, if this consumer group is down, then what is going to happen is, this messaging system is going to ensure that the messages are kept in the messaging system for service C1 or for service C, so that when this service comes back up, then its consumers can start consuming the messages that have been published in the messaging system. What you can also do is, for example, if you have some service or some messages which do not want real-time consumption, so what publishers can do is, publishers can just publish these messages in the messaging system, and they can basically keep lying in the messaging system. And when, for example, if you have scheduled tasks which run, or if you have scheduled processing or off-hours processing, what you can do is you can spawn the consumer instances. They can basically pick these messages, consume them, process them, and get the work done. So what is going to happen is, you can decouple the production and consumption of particular workload. Producer can produce at their will and consumers can consume at their will. Also, what is going to happen is, sending changes is going to be easy, because all you have to do, all the producers have to adhere to the message format or the payload format in which messages should be published in the messaging system. So they have to adhere to format. And then all you have to do is, publishers have to adhere to the format so that all the messages are produced in a single format, and you can basically create consumers adhering to this format, and it is going to decouple your system. For example, this code can be written in Java, this code can be written in Node.js, this code can be written in Python. So it is going to decouple your systems. It is going to make testing easier, because all the testing in this scenario is going to be message format and the SLA at which messages should be published. And similarly, consumers have to be tested what is the action done for a particular message. So it improves your testing also. You can basically also monitor what are your queue lengths that can help you measure the performance of your system. And during peak loads, if producer P is producing large amounts of data, then consumers are not going to get overwhelmed. All that is going to happen is it is going to increase the unconsumed messages in the messaging system, which are going to be consumed by the consumers as per their own pace. They can continue consumption at their own pace. Otherwise, in directly coupled system, what would have happened is, if there was a large amount of load on the producing system, then similar load would be sent to the downstream system, which can increase load on these services. And if they are not properly handled, then these services can crash. Also, adding and removing consumers and producers is very easy. All they have to do is adhere to the format and the SLA with which messages are produced and consumed, and everything is going to work fine. So it improves integration in big companies, because teams are not bound by the code level integration, they are bound by the messaging system level integrations. It is also going to, using messaging system or publishing subscriber pattern, is also going to improve your producer and consumer performance, because all that producer has to do is produce a message. It is not dependent on the processing done by the consumer services. So it improves the efficiency of the producers. Similarly, consumers are not dependent on the rate at which data is produced by the producers. So it decouples them and improves the efficiency for producers as well as consumers. Now let's see what other qualities do we need in a good production grade messaging system. First of all, it should provide subscription capabilities so that producers and consumers can basically subscribe and unsubscribe to the messaging system or channels. For example, if this producer wants to subscribe to this channel, this is the channel. If it wants to produce, it can subscribe to it. It can basically, and it can produce to it. And similarly, consumers can subscribe to consuming from a particular channel. And if they don't want to subscribe to that channel, they can unsubscribe. If they don't want the data, they can unsubscribe from the channel. So this facility should be provided by the messaging system. Similarly, security is very essential. Production and consumption both should be used with authentication and authorization. Authentication means that there should be password or certificate level authentication, so that only rightful entities can produce and consume from the channel. Also, there should be authorization. For example, only publishers who are authorized to publish in, let's say, topic X or QX should be allowed to publish in it. Any other person who is not authorized, or any other service which is not authorized to produce in channel X, should not be allowed. Similarly, unauthorized consumption from a particular channel can be controlled. This should be provided by the messaging system. So authentication and authorization. It should also provide content filtering and subset of messages. For example, in a messaging system, there is a lot of data that is being published by multiple types of producers. There are multiple types of producers in the messaging system. So it your messaging system should provide different subsets of data, or it should be possible that consumers can subscribe to different subset of data. For example, if they only want order updates, then they should be able to get only order updates. They should not be forced to take all the data that is being passed in the system. Similarly, if there are multiple topics, let's say multiple queues, Q1, Q2, and 3, and if a consumer or consumer group wants to subscribe to multiple queues, then it should also be possible. So your messaging system should provide wildcard basis or regex pattern based subscription, so that all the queues whose name starts with Q, or all the queues with whose name starts with sub, should be subscribed by this service. So it can subscribe to sub star. So all the queues whose name starts with sub will be subscribed by this consumer C. and all the queues whose name starts with dub star will be consumed by the consumer service D. So this is wildcard subscription. Now one more thing you have to keep in mind is in publishing subscriber pattern, there is unidirectional flow of information. So publisher is publishing the data in the messaging system and consumer is consuming the data. Consumers are consuming the data. And if you want to reply to the publisher, then you have to use some other pattern. For example, what you can do is you can create another queue or in the same messaging system, and the consumers can basically produce the data or produce the replies that they want to give up for a particular message, and then this queue can be read back by the producer. So generally what happens is in a publisher subscriber pattern, it is a unidirectional flow of information in this direction. And if you want to complete this cycle, then you have to make out you have to make custom functionalities using different queues. You have to ensure that when you are consuming from the message, then your application should be idempotent so that the ordering in which messages are published or order in which messages are published does not affect the processing of messages in your consumer service. For example, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So what can happen is these messages can be consumed by your service in multiple patterns, like first 1, then 3, then 2, then 5, then 4. This can be also possible due to, because you can have multiple consumers in your service and all these consumers can compete between one another to get a particular message. So the order in which messages are processed should not affect the consistency in your system. Your service should be idempotent to the ordering of the messages. Also, if you want priority, for example, if a message with priority 0 is published, then it should be consumed before the message with priority 1. If you need these type of system, then you should select the systems which provide priority ordering of messages. Otherwise, you can create your own priority queuing by using multiple queues. We have discussed this separately in another video. Since it's a distributed system and failures are imminent, failures can happen anytime, then you have to be prepared for cases like when there is a poison message. This poison message can be a malformed message. It can be a message whose format is not adherent to the format in which general messages are published in this system. So what can happen is your service can crash. So what you have to do is if there is a poison message in the messaging system, so your service should handle it gracefully. It should keep this message in the logs or in a dead letter queue or someplace else so that it can be checked later, and subsequent messages should be consumed from the queuing system. Your application should not crash. You should handle poison messages. Your application, you have to make sure that your application is ensuring that repeated messages are either not being sent by your application, or if they are being sent, then consumers should be aware that they should handle repeated messages. It should not affect the consistency on the consumer side. So repeated messages should be handled both at producer side and consumer side. Some messaging systems provide expiration. For example, if a particular message remains in the message queue for some X amount of duration, what can happen is this message can expire. It depends upon the functionality provided by the messaging system that when upon expiry, what is going to happen. One thing can happen is it can be dropped from the messaging system, which can lead to loss of data. Another possibility is you can put this message in another queue or in some log so that this message can be consumed or processed at a later point of time. So expiration of messages may be provided by some messaging systems. You can check that. RabbitMQ provides message expiry upon which messages can be published to some other exchanges. You can also do message scheduling in some messaging systems. What happens in message scheduling is during the time of production of message, what you can provide is a time at which this message should be available to consumers. So what you can do is you can create a message with time at, let's say, 10 p.m. So currently it is 9 p.m. Your message will sit in the message queue and it won't be available for consumption. It will be invisible to the consumers. So messaging system is going to ensure that this message is not delivered to the system, or consumers are not basically able to see this message. Once its respected time or scheduled time is fulfilled, then only this message becomes available for consumption to the consumer. So in this way, you can ensure that this message or particular message is consumed after a particular amount of time or at a particular time. This is called message scheduling. And this is also available in some messaging systems. Now, all these extra benefits that a messaging system provides, they can have hidden costs in it in terms of performance and in terms of availability. So while deciding your messaging system, you have to compare the pros and cons of the messaging system. Do you want a more durable system or do you want a more versatile system? Also, you have to keep in mind that when messaging systems are coming in picture, they bring eventual consistency with them. The action that is taken by the producer, that is publishing in the message queue, is not immediately consumed by the consumer. It is eventually consumed by the consumer. So the action taken by the consumer is also eventual. Right. So if, for example, if any request comes to P, then it is published in the, it is published in the messaging system, then it is eventually read by the consumer and then it is done, or that action is taken by the consumer. So it is eventual consistent system that is created when using messaging pattern. Now, this type of publisher subscriber pattern is most useful when you have broadcast type of scenarios. For example, if multiple services want to listen for a particular messages, then this type of scenario suits publisher subscriber pattern. But if only one service is present and it is a very small system, then using a messaging system is going to increase complexity. So that's all for the publisher subscriber pattern. I hope you enjoyed the video. Please let me know your views and comments. And thank you and have a nice day.